So guys, so a lot going on this week. Everyone's still talking about Russia and Ukraine and possibility of nuclear, and now we're talking about Elon Musk and Twitter. But if you follow me for the past couple of days, this past week, I've been super shadow banned. But I've been talking about Halloween and the obvious inconsistency that we're seeing within the church and the body of Christ today when it comes to the topic of Halloween and how many of us agree and disagree or agree to disagree on the topic of the obvious holiday called Halloween that is not of God, right? So there's a lot I want to say, so please stay tuned. Please listen to me. I'm not trying to be divisive. I'm also not trying to be argumentative. I'm just trying to be as consistent as I possibly can be scripturally and then historically and then everything else in between. But we must stand on the rock, and that is his word, right? All right, so if you're listening, listen closely. One of the reasons that the church failed in 2020, I'm talking about shut down, pastors were ridiculed for standing against the obvious Antichrist agenda that was afoot. I'm talking about pastors not preaching the truth, not standing for the truth, and congregations and fellow brothers and sisters in Christ not standing on the truth is because many Christians today do not know the word. They don't know the word. They don't live in the word. The word is not their bread and butter. Just as Jesus said, he said, man shall not live off of bread alone, but by every word that proceeded from the mouth of God. Many people today are not living their life according to the word, but according to how the world perceives the word. And there's a difference between the two. That's why we see many popular Christians today standing for godlessness. A lot of people are asking, what happened to the church? Why couldn't the church discern BLM? Why couldn't the church discern critical race theory? Why couldn't the church discern evolution? Why couldn't the church discern the sexual revolution? Why couldn't the church discern transgenderism? Why couldn't the church stand up against this A, B, C, D, or E, F, or G? Simple. Because the church has not been living in spirit and in truth. They have not been worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth. They have not been walking with the Lord in spirit and in truth. And when you don't do those things, this is the very same things the Lord told us to do, we get lost in the sauce. Which sauce? The sauce of the world. We get deceived. We are destroyed. Because of why? Lack of knowledge. That's where many believers are today. That's where most of the church is today. And that's where most pastors are today. They do not have spiritual eyes to see or spiritual ears to hear the Lord and what he's speaking. And he speaks through his word. When I decided to follow Jesus 5-6 years ago, when I really repented, turned from my sins, decided to follow him, I read the word, the entire thing. And I realized, wow, I was never really a Christian. I was never really a Christian because I did not live the way Jesus told me to live. I didn't follow his word. I wasn't filled with the Holy Spirit. So I didn't have spiritual eyes to see. I didn't have spiritual ears to hear him. And the Holy Spirit wasn't living inside of me to obey the word and walk out my faith. That's where we are at today. That's why we have conversations like Halloween, which you would think someone who's living a consistent, spirit-filled life, this wouldn't be up for debate. But because we're living in times where people do not have the Holy Spirit to discern the truth, we have to have these conversations. All right, so stick with me. You read the first 5 books of Moses. You read Genesis. You read Exodus. You read Leviticus. You read Numbers. You read Deuteronomy. Specifically Deuteronomy chapter 6 and chapter 12. Study them. Deuteronomy specifically was written to a generation who did not see God deliver his people out of Egypt. They weren't raised to see the miraculous wonders of God. So they were given the law a second time. They had to have been given the law a second time so that they would know how to follow the Lord. What does the Lord want of you? What does he love? What does he not love? How should you live your life? How should you walk? How should you dress? What are your customs? A people set apart, live set apart lives. That was the point. You're set apart for a purpose, by the one who created you on purpose. Right? There were natural customs that God's people lived by, and there are spiritual customs that they lived by. There is a custom in the way of living that other nations did not have, that the nation of Israel did have, because they had the one true God who delivered them out of Egypt. And other nations knew this, and other nations were afraid of Israel for a very short period of time because they knew and they saw and they heard the miraculous works of the living God. I'll get to Halloween in a second, just have to lay the groundwork. There is a way that God has required his people to live. There is a way that we ought to live our life in accordance to other customs of the world that are not of God, that do not care about his ways, do not care about his customs, do not care about the way that God has ordained his people to live. A people that have been called set apart. You are set apart. You're part of a royal priesthood, a chosen generation. You have been set apart. So by that logic, if you have been natural logic and spiritual logic, right? Spiritual wisdom. By that logic, if you have been set apart, are there things that you have been set apart from and set apart for? 100%. Because you've been redeemed. And we'll get to that word in a second. You've been redeemed. You've been called out from something and called into something. You weren't called out of something to just stay out. You've been called out to get into something else. And that is, you've been called out of the world, set apart from the world, and you've been called into the kingdom of God that has another set of rules, customs, and a way of life. Right? Isaiah 55 says, God's ways are not our ways, his thoughts are not our thoughts. Just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are his ways higher than our ways, and his thoughts than our thoughts. God's ways are not the ways of the world. God's ways are also not our ways. Neither is the ways that we would actively choose, because we, by definition, don't really want to live the way he wants us to live. We don't really want to believe what he wants us to believe, which is why we have to die to ourselves, die to our flesh, take up our cross daily and follow him. The Christian life is not for chumps. It's not for the weak-minded. It's not for the weak at heart. It's for those who have a new spirit and have a new mind, not a carnal mind, but a spiritual mind, to ascertain and believe spiritual things and spiritual truths. We have been called out of darkness into light. Now, Halloween. There is no good reason for Christians to celebrate Halloween. There's not one good logical argument, either biblically, historically, or culturally, for a Christian who is set apart, called out of darkness into light, in another kingdom, not a kingdom of this world, but another kingdom, to celebrate Halloween. It's not of us, it's not of our people. There's absolutely no reason for a Christian who has been enlightened by the Spirit of Truth to go back into the darkness. There's not one good reason. And so when I hear Christians try to argue culturally and try to argue historically for a Christian, another believer, born again, spirit-filled believer, to participate in Halloween, I scratch my head or my beard. And I ask myself a couple questions. Why would someone fight and argue so bad who has been called out to go back in and fight for something that was never of the Lord in the first place? Halloween never belonged to God, right? So when I hear people make the argument, oh, we can redeem all things unto the glory of God. No, you can't. That's unscriptural. That's unbiblical. You cannot redeem all things unto the glory of God, because Halloween wasn't created for God's glory. The very definition of the word redeem in Latin, re means back, emere, right, E-M-E-R-E, means to buy. The word redeem means to buy back. You cannot buy back or redeem Halloween, because it never belonged to the Lord at all. Right, which makes me understand that most believers have no idea what the word redeem actually really means. And so they use it to make it sound as if you can just take things that are of the world and sprinkle Jesus over it, as if it's some extra spice to spice things up a bit and make it holy, and God would be okay with it. God doesn't work that way. Sorry, but God don't work that way. He doesn't, and he never has, and he never will. He's not about to change for you. He's the very same yesterday, today, and forever. He's not going to change for you. He's not going to change for me. We change for him. We are renewed for him. Our minds are renewed for him, so that we can obey him, his ways, his world, his kingdom, on his time. So we cannot redeem Halloween. That it doesn't make any sense to me how Christians try to make an argument from a place where there has no foundation for them to argue for. Right? I was redeemed. You were redeemed. We were redeemed. Redeemed from what? Redeemed from sin. Because we were once in relationship with the Lord. We were once in relationship with the Father. We were once in relationship with the Son and the Holy Spirit. And because of sin, we fell from that grace and we had a sin nature that we needed to get saved from. Because if we stayed in our sin nature, we would be excommunicated from the kingdom of God, excommunicated out of his presence into eternal damnation. Hell is eternal, contrary to many popular opinions. It's eternal because it is against God's nature. We sinned against God, who is eternal. And because we sinned against him, who is eternal, hell must be eternal as well. It's not some place that's just like, I'm going to put them there as punishment just for a little while and take them out. No. It is eternal separation from God. We sinned against God. Go read Psalms 51. David's like, in you alone, O Lord, have I sinned against. That's what Ephesians chapter 2 says. It says, and you once who were dead in your trespasses and sin, but God, who is rich in mercy, steadfast in love, that while we were dead in our trespasses and sin, made us alive together in Christ. Jesus redeemed us by the blood. The blood he shed upon the cross, it was not cheap. It cost him his life. So that you and I can have eternal life. That was the point. We were separated in sin. But because of the blood of Jesus, we have been redeemed, bought back into his presence. So that we can be called children of God. John chapter 1. All this is scripture. I'm not talking out my butt. It's Bible. Common theme for everyone arguing for Halloween. Notice they don't argue from the Bible. They argue from history. They argue from philosophy and they argue from culture. They do the exact same things the Lord tells us not to do. Because they know, many of them know, if they argue from the Bible, there is no argument. We have been called out of darkness into light, out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, the kingdom of the Son whom he loves, Colossians chapter 1. Read 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Do not be unequally yoked. What fellowship does light have with darkness? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. What does that say? Do not love the appearance of evil. What spirit did the Lord give us? Question. Pop quiz. And this is how you know whether someone is really walking in spirit and in truth, right? Your Bible, 1 John chapter 4, write all those verses that I have mentioned before down, study them, read them in context. 1 John chapter 4 says, beloved, test every spirit to see whether or not it is of God. Not test every philosophy, not test every culture, not test every historicity and every fact of history so that you can come to your conclusion. It says, test every spirit. Christians aren't doing that today. You know what they're doing? Because they want so much to fight for their traditions. They want so much to fight for culture. They want to win culture so bad that they're willing to dabble in the very same thing that's deceiving the culture, which is the spirit of the age. But I'll get to that. What spirit did the Lord give us? What did 1 John chapter 4 say? What spirit did the Lord give us? The spirit of the age is the spirit of deception. Is an antichrist spirit. I'm not hyper-spiritualizing anything. That's what your Bible says. It is the spirit of deception. It is the spirit of the age. It is an antichrist spirit. Go back, read 1 John chapter 4. This is why people couldn't ascertain. They couldn't discern. They couldn't understand. They didn't have the knowledge to see what happened in 2020, what happened in 2021, whether it's with the sexual revolution, whether it's with transgenderism, whether it's with BLM, whether it's with witchcraft, whether it's with the vacky. People couldn't, most Christians couldn't discern. Want to know why? Because the same spirit that's in the world found its way in the church a long time ago. Found its way in the church. That's why many churches close. That's why many churches aren't preaching the true, pure word of God. Because the spirit of the world is in the church. Back to our pop quiz. What spirit did the Lord give us? What spirit did the Lord give us? Lord did not give us a spirit of fear. That's our first clue. but of power, love, and a sound mind.
Okay.
What is the spirit of Halloween? I already know some of you are listening like, I don't want to hear this. I don't want to hear this because you're going to be convicted. But you're going to hear it anyways. What is the spirit behind Halloween? Is it a spirit of power? Is it the spirit of love? No. Is it the spirit of a sound mind? No. So what spirit is a spirit of Halloween? Oh, it's an antichrist spirit. Oh, because it doesn't glorify God. Oh, it's a spirit of fear. Oh, okay, so let's put this together. All right, let's put this together. So the Lord did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Halloween is not the spirit of the Lord, but in fact, it's a spirit of fear. So if Halloween is not the spirit of the Lord and it's the spirit of fear, therefore is not the spirit of God, therefore Christians should not participate in Halloween. That's a logically consistent argument against Halloween. The Lord did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. The spirit of Halloween is a spirit of fear. Therefore, the spirit behind Halloween is not a spirit of God. So therefore, Christians should not participate in Halloween because it's not of God. Sound logic. Simple. But Christians today don't want to heed the word of God. Right? So when I see Christians argue, and they don't argue intellectually, right, about the conversation. They don't argue spiritually about it. They argue from their own personal convictions, their feelings. My friend, I don't care about your feelings. Feelings is why we're here in the first place with our country. I don't care about your feelings. I need something that is authoritative, that is objective, and that is extreme, so supernatural that it oversees my natural cognitive abilities to understand. I need something beyond me that is stable and that is on the ground, that is so supernaturally consistent that I don't have to worry about waking up the next morning and things are going to change. They're not going to change because God is consistent. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's faithful just like that. We're not faithful. We're flawed and we flip-flop and we're okay one day and the next day we're all over the place and we're inconsistent. The one thing that's consistent about humanity is that we're inconsistent. Right? We're inconsistent. We would much rather fight for things that are in the dark, although we're no longer of the dark. We are of the light now. We have the armor of God. They have the armor of light. We are of the light now. We would much rather fight for things in the dark than fight for things that we have that are in our own kingdom. Why would you fight for Halloween, a pagan, dark, demonic, satanic holiday? Because the word says so. I don't even have to go to history, because history is dark itself and proves that as a historical fact, that it is not of God. But even if that wasn't a good argument, the word says that we have a different spirit than the world. So from jump, from that natural ground of argumentation, why would I fight for something that's in the dark? It's stupid. It's dumb. It's foolish. The Bible calls it foolishness. Right? Why would I fight for something that belongs to the dark when I belong to the light? When I'm not of this world. I'm in the world, but I'm not of this world. I'm of a different world. What type of world? A supernatural world where there is a supernatural, powerful kingdom of light. Why would I do such a thing? Colossians chapter 1 tells us, we have been translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, the kingdom of the Son whom he loves. We're in a completely different kingdom, but here we have kingdom citizens fighting for things that don't belong to the kingdom of God. How in the world does that work? I'm confused. I'm really confused. We need to redeem these things for the glory of God. Impossible. Doesn't belong. It never belonged to God in the first place. So we can't redeem something that doesn't belong to God. You can't take something from the world and sprinkle Jesus over it and think Jesus will be okay with it. Don't work that way. It has never worked that way. And once again, it will never work that way. All right, so when I hear Christians say, oh, well, if you're going to say this is pagan, that means everything is pagan. Your chair is pagan. Your TV is pagan. Your phone's pagan. Social media is pagan. Instagram is pagan. YouTube is pagan. That's pagan. I'm like, thank you for proving to me you do not know how to logically think. That's a fallacious argument. If I say one thing is pagan, I'm not saying everything is pagan. That's very, very bad argumentation. That's actually an equivocation fallacy. By making one phrase or one portion of the argument as if I'm saying the other portion of the argument is the exact same thing. It's not. I'm not making one holiday equal to other holidays because they're not equal. We're judging things by the spirit. That's how Bible-believing Christians judge things. We don't judge things fallaciously. We judge things by the spirit. The wisdom of this world is foolish to the wisdom of God. That's what 1 Corinthians chapter 1, chapter 2 says. So when I hear people say, oh, you must think God is really small and you know, the devil's really big. If you know, you think the devil has one day alone during like October 31st belongs to him, like Halloween belongs to him. You know, we were called to plunder hell and we were called to destroy hell. And we were called to go into the world and redeem the world. And I'm like, pause. Are you listening to yourself? Because nothing of what you're saying to tickle people's ears actually lines up with what the word actually says. How can you plunder hell while playing with hell's created devices to deceive, divide, and destroy? Make that make sense for me. Oh, you can't make it make sense because it doesn't make sense. Because we first rightly divide the word of truth by the spirit of the word. That's how you test the spirit first. It's the spirit. Right, but back to arguing about why Christians today who are of the light want to fight so bad for things that belong to the darkness. We have our own. The Lord is so good that he knew that humanity loves to celebrate. We love to celebrate. We love a good party. We love rejoicing. Did you know God has his own days? Uh-oh. Don't go there, Kevin. Do you know God has his own holidays? Have you read Leviticus 23 lately? Because he says that those are his feast days, his celebrations, forever. Not just till tomorrow. Not once a year. On a specific day. In October. No, God has his own days. And they're going to be so amazing that people from every nation and tribe will come. I'm going to end it right here. But I've noticed many people who are arguing vehemently so for Halloween never argue for the Feast of the Lord. They don't talk about it. It's kind of like, I don't even want to say they don't talk about it. It's almost as if they purposely ignore it. But they're willing to fight. Many of us are willing to fight for a day that was separated onto the dead. Then fight to celebrate the Lord's feast. When I was born again and I saw this, I said, wow, I've really been living in disobedience. That's where most Christians are today. Just disobedient. God, I want to do my own thing when I want to do it. Don't tell me nothing. That's where we're at. That's where most believers are today. They just want to do their own thing. You know, it's like what the people told Jeremiah in the 18th chapter. They said, Jeremiah, don't waste your breath. We will continue to live as we want to, stubbornly following our own evil devices. Go read that chapter. Go read what the Lord told Jeremiah to tell his people and what the people turned right back around and told Jeremiah. Jeremiah, don't waste your breath. We're going to do what we want to do. We're going to still follow our own desires. We're going to do what we're going to worship who we want. We're going to follow who we want. We're going to dress the way we want. We're going to live the way we want. Don't tell us nothing. We're right back. We're right there. You want to know how God dealt with his people back then? He sent them into captivity. He allowed Babylon, and he called Nebuchadnezzar his servant. He allowed Babylon to ransack Jerusalem and bring them into captivity because they were disobedient. Are we right back there again? I would say yes. Right, so for some encouragement. For everyone who used to follow Halloween, used to celebrate it, loved workers of darkness, loved the appearance of darkness, just loved the day because it was just so enticing and it was like tradition and it was a form of bonding with family and friends and your kids. And you've seen the light, you've seen the truth. Don't feel bad, just learn from it. Grow and remember, you are no longer of the dark right? And Paul, in his letter to the Thessalonians, in context, he's talking about the day of the Lord, the return of the Lord. But he's like, but you brothers, you're not in the darkness, right? So don't expect that day to take you by surprise. You are sons of the light and sons of the day. You are not sons of the dark. You are not sons of the night. You don't belong to the night anymore. That's the framework we have. Those who belong to the light should not fight for things that belong to the dark. It's just very simple. If you no longer are in the dark, but you are not of the darkness, you should not be fighting for things that are of the darkness. If you have another spirit, and the spirit in the world, because that's the argument of the Bible, that's spiritual wisdom. If you do not have the spirit of the world, you have another spirit, which is the spirit of God, the spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. You should not be fighting for the spirit of the world. That's just spiritual wisdom. That's just spiritual common sense. That's spiritual logic. There's no reason for a born-again, spirit-filled believer, a child of the Most High God, to be fighting for something that belongs to the spirit of the world. Does not make any sense. Stop it. Stop. So anywho, thank you for coming to my spiritual TED Talk. Pray that was edifying. Of course, there are so many people who won't want to do what they want to do. Most Christians will. And I'm addressing this to the body of Christ. I'm not addressing this to non-believers. Because if you're a non-believer, you want to celebrate Halloween, I pray that the spirit of this world frightens you so bad that you run to the one true God. That's my prayer for you. That you get frightened so bad that you run to Christ. But if you're a Christian, there's no reason for you to be celebrating things that belong to the dark when you are light of the world. Day, 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 day.